Welcome to a very special First Word program. I'm Paul Crouch, Jr., your host. We are here in Nashville, Tennessee, at the National Religious Broadcasters Convention. You can see the signage above my shoulder. And we are here with Your Word Network. We've got a beautiful display, a beautiful booth. We brought the Word bus down from Detroit. And we're here just meeting different people, talking about technology, talking about Christian television, and talking about how we can more effectively affect and change people's lives. So stay tuned. I think you'll get a good education on kind of what's going on in the Christian media, what's going on in the Christian world. And I'm excited to bring this program to you. So let's go now and take a look at the sights and sounds of NRB 2014. Take a look. Well, you never know who you're going to run into here at NRB, but Kevin Downs, how are you?
It's good to see you, Paul.
Now, Kevin, again, will be one of those faces. If you watch Christian films, you have seen him in, you have to be in 30, 40 different films, haven't you?
You know what? It's amazing that you say that. It actually hasn't been that many.
Really?
I still think I'm around 20, but maybe more.
Just name off a couple.
Well, it started with The Moment After and Mercy Streets. There was The Moment After 2. Sixth, Mark Unleashed. Lately, of course, I'm here for Mom's Night Out, which is a movie that I'm in, as well as produced. It's a family comedy, laugh out loud, hilarious family comedy. Comes out Mother's Day weekend, May 9th, in theaters everywhere.
But it's still, you know, that's something that's kind of an oxymoron, a Christian film or a family film that's a comedy. It's tough.
It's totally an oxymoron. It's been fun. We've done a few pre-release screenings, and the audiences they're not really sure what to expect. And people are like, I think they're in shock at the end of it because they've never seen a like Christian comedy before because it's total oxymoron. It's like, how do you have a Christian comedy? But it was very well executed. The Irwin brothers directed the film. They are amazing at what they do. They're incredible. Our cast is amazing. Patricia Heaton, Sarah Drew, Trace Adkins, who's wonderful. Sean Astin, who's incredible in the film. Andrew Logan White is awesome. Some courageous faces, not just myself, but Alex Kendrick, Robert Amaya. And it's a fun cast. It's a lot of fun. Yeah.
And how would somebody find out about it, go see it, download it? How do you do that?
Momsnightoutmovie.com is where you go. Register your email address, and you'll get more information on the theatrical release. Again, May 9th in theaters. We're on Facebook, Mom's Night Out on Facebook. Like us there. And there's all sorts of resource materials on the internet, Mom's Night Out, to check it out.
Mom, Beck's playing in the toilet again! Surprise, we made you a less sugar!
Oh no, 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 he's gonna put that in his mouth and become one of the 400 estimated people that die from acute salmonella. We're not put that finger in your...
Oh, you having a rough morning?
Tell me it's all gonna be okay.
It's all gonna be okay, just give it 5 years.
Year seven or five...
You have to choose to do something for yourself.
I planned this mom's night thing for Saturday.
You planned a mom's night?
Yes, sister.
What's the worst thing that can happen?
They could get maimed. I could lose both children. It's getting hot in here.
Wow, you look amazing.
Ladies, tonight is our night, and we look good.
I cannot find your reservation.
I just want to sit down with my friends without three little people clawing all over me.
You're getting a little angry, and it's doing something ugly to your face.
Joey.
You're supposed to be watching our baby. Who has him?
Phones.
He's at the tattoo parlor.
Who would bring a baby to a tattoo parlor? That's dumb.
I know.
That is real dumb.
Okay, so here's the plan. We take them inside, get their hands stamped, and they can't get out. Like Shawshank Redemption.
Bones, my baby.
I called Caprice, and Caprice said she'd take him.
Where's the van?
I had tonight playing out differently in my mind.
We got a baby to find.
Hank, where's the baby?
I don't know.
Allie, it's me. Just wanted to let you know that everything's going great here. We're all good. We're going to take a little trip to the hospital.
Life is about finding the meaning and the joy and the purpose in all the chaos.
Hon, your job.
It's hard, I know.
Important. That's what I was going to say.
That's my van! Get the van! The van!
This has been the worst night ever. I honestly don't know how it could get any worse.
Stand down!
How dare you? My husband is passionate.
Sir, they just came in here and started... That was an accident.
We're with somebody who probably needs no introduction. Patricia Heaton, how are you?
I'm well, thanks.
Now, everybody's going to remember you from a small little show that I think aired, what, about 50 years or something. What was that?
Everybody Loves Raymond.
That's right.
Yeah, and then currently I'm on the ABC show The Middle on Wednesday nights.
Yeah. Well, talk about your faith a little bit. I know I saw you kind of hosting a Thou Shalt Laugh program. I mean, you've really kind of come out more recently about your faith. Talk about that just for a minute.
Well, I think with the advent of social media, there's more opportunity to sort of be who you are with your fans and followers. I was raised, you know, very Catholic family, parents, daily communicants. My oldest sister's a Dominican nun. I was brought up in the faith, and I'm one of the ones where I never left it, so... I don't really label it. I like to do comedies.
Yeah.
So, I mean, to me, every film is a faith-based film. It's just everybody has their faith in something different, you know? So I don't really like to put a label on it, because then I think you tend to alienate a whole part of our population if you kind of try to stick any kind of label on a movie. If it's a political movie, you know, everything starts feeling like propaganda. And the fact is, with this movie, Mom's Night Out, that's opening May 9th. It's when a couple, a family, they're working hard from Monday through Friday, and they're spending money on gas and popcorn and parking and a babysitter and a movie. I want them to be entertained and to feel great when they leave the theater, and to feel renewed and to have had a nice time together and been able to laugh. I feel so blessed that I'm able to do comedy, because I think it's such a salve for the soul. And so that's what this movie is about. It's to just really entertain and affirm what people are going through, especially raising your children when they're younger. But the movie kind of represents all kinds of parenting and the roles of husbands and wives and the need to get out there and renew yourself and get refreshed. And so I remember when I was doing Raymond, speaking of that, you know, I had... By the fourth season, I had four children age 5 and under. And so, I know how exhausting it is. And it can be really tough on your marriage, too. So this movie is really sort of there to affirm what people are doing and going through as a parent.
We are here with Andrea Logan White, actor and missionary trying to affect and change people's lives through film. Would that be accurate?
That's right.
Yeah.
Yep.
Mom's Night Out, latest movie you were in. Talk about it a little bit.
Mom's Night Out is, first of all, a comedy. It's about family. It's about moms struggling to find the balance in marriage and family, single moms, moms with multiple children,
pregnant moms. So it's a fun ride. There's a lot of suffering in life, and a lot of and it can happen in two ways. It's fight or flight, or you find the human. You find the humor in that. And so David and I had a part. We developed the film. We have a lot of, you know, we're exhausted at the end of the day, trying to find, you know, find each other at the end of the day when you have kids and have a family, and to try to revive the marriage and have the balance of family and children. And then, of course, have your faith first and foremost. And so we really are passionate about bringing a clean family comedy to, you know, to everybody, that they can bring their kids with kids, grandmothers, everybody of all ages, to really just escape their life and to know that you're not alone. I moved to Hollywood to pursue my dream of acting, and I was not a Christian. So I became a Christian later in life when I was 22. So I kind of got to the end of myself and said I could either live this crazy lifestyle trying to do it on my own, or become a Christian, put God first. And when you put God first, everything else falls into place. And he gives you what your dreams, because he puts those desires on your heart, and then some. So it's just a blessing. I met David at church shortly after I became a Christian in my 20s. And I actually laid down acting and I said, Lord, if this is something that you've called me to do, you need to put it in my lap and make it very clear. And so it's been a blessing to be able to develop and create films with my husband, have a family, and have an awesome career. So it's been a blessing.
Our company is PureFlix Entertainment. Our desire is to make films that uplift and inspire the human spirit, that ultimately bring people to higher levels of insight to who God is and the purpose that he has for their lives. And quite frankly, you know, I'm a strong believer in Jesus Christ. And as I make films based on my worldview and based on what I believe, it's based on the Bible and the truths of the Bible. And so ultimately, it's led me to the Christian film world. And I'm grateful to be here.
Well, the last one I just saw, God's Not Dead, is that your latest one with PureFlix?
Yep, that's the one that's coming out March 21. And in about 700 theaters, we're proud of it. And has a great cast, but also just, I think it's one of the most important things. We went around asking pastors, what do they want to see in a Christian film? And a lot of them said something about apologetics, something about why do Christians believe what they believe? Because a lot of people don't know what that is. And this movie really puts you as a person center stage and asks you the question, what do you believe? Is there a God or is there not a God? Which is the most important question that anybody can ever ask, because it governs the entire way you live your life.
All this stuff, it's temporary. Money, success, even life is temporary. Jesus, that's eternal.
And that's it?
That's it. That's what we're going with.
I'm Professor Radisson.
This semester, I propose that we refuse to waste our limited time together debating the existence of the big man in the sky. Fill in the papers I've just given you with three little words. God is dead.
I can't do what you want. I'm a Christian.
The answer's simple. Drop the class.
It's like it's something that God wants me to do. I can't just turn away from it.
Somehow. If you cannot bring yourself to admit that God is dead, then you will need to defend the antithesis. Let hope arise
and make the darkness. You're here because that voice inside you isn't happy with the choices everyone else wants you to make. It's not easy, but it's simple.
Do you think you're smarter than me, Wheaton? Do you think there's any argument you can make that I won't have an answer for? In that classroom, there is a God, and yet, I'm him.
I think you're here kind of hoping that this stuff is for real.
To me, he's not dead. He's alive.
What I want is for them to make their own choice. That's what God wants.
You just want to ensnare them in your primitive superstition.
Science supports his existence. You know the truth. So why do you hate him? Why do you hate God? He's not dead, he's surely alive. He's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. God's not dead, he's surely alive. He's living on the inside, roaring.
You know, the neat thing about bringing a movie to a theater is I think the theater experience, people open up their hearts in their lives almost more than they would. They'll allow a movie to take them to places where they wouldn't even allow their best friend to take them. And that's something that only a movie, I believe, can do, you know?
So religion is like a disease?
Yes. Yes, it infects everything. It's the enemy of reason.
Reason? Professor, you left reason a long time ago. What you're teaching here isn't philosophy. It's not even atheism anymore. What you're teaching is anti-theism. It's not enough that you don't believe. You need all of us to not believe with you.
Why don't you admit the truth? You just want to ensnare them in your primitive superstition.
What I want is for them to make their own choice. That's what God wants.
You have no idea how much I'm going to enjoy failing you.
Yeah, but who are you really looking to fail, Professor? Me? Or God?
My goodness. Well, the balance is really, really hard. Thankfully, I have a great husband, and he's a great, great, great dad. So that helps. And it also helps that we're both in the business, so we understand that the hours, when you're in production, they're endless. And you're running on fumes, and you collapse. But I think, I don't know how much we pray. I mean, we pray all day, every day, you know, to get through it. And we have a great au pair who's amazing, who's like a big sister to our kids. And, you know, we have a lot of great friends and family that are always offering to help us. And then we bring our kids. I mean, our kids don't just, they're on set. So they've grown up on our sets. And they kind of know what mommy and daddy do, and we welcome them, and they're family. So our sets are family. So everybody just welcomes them. And it's a great thing to be able to do that, and then just to bring them on.
The challenges to a marriage. I mean, talk about that a little bit. It's tough.
Yeah. I think any marriage has challenges, you know, in and of itself already. And then you add in the entertainment industry on top of that. With, you know, Hollywood's first priority is not successful marriages, you know. And so, but I think any marriage can't sustain itself without Jesus Christ at the very center. And so that's ultimately what we do, is we fall on our face before the Lord, and we say, Lord, give us strength, give us wisdom, help me to be a better husband, help Andrea to be a better wife. Now she's a great wife. And ultimately the Lord heals us, because we are ultimately we're selfish, we're human, and then on top of it, we're actors on top of that, and so you just double the neuroses, the self-obsession.
But then to try to keep God first in an industry that breeds obsession and self-obsession and selfishness and narcissism, that's like trying to keep God first. And with every project that we do, we pray and even ask God to give us the actors and the people that are supposed to be on our films, and to give us the grace and the strength to, you know, to endure it.
Well, you know, one of the neat things about being here at NRB is meeting friends and industry professionals. Dan Ruppel, how are you, my friend?
Doing well, Paul. Good to see you.
Good to see you. You were here actually teaching some classes on what?
Well, I was talking a lot about connecting with the millennial generation, the digital generation. You know, we're baby boomers. We grew up on television, which is a flat screen. It's a monologue being broadcast into us. The receiver is very passive. It's appointment television. And now the way that the younger generation, the emerging generation, is engaging and consuming media is 24/7. Highly interactive. They're plugging into a multi-source dialogue that's going on globally. So we have to be aware of why they're gravitating to that kind of media, and why those types of mediums that are being broadcast, the content, what is it about it that appeals to them? And so we need to change our model a little bit and start saying, well, just instead of just presenting a TV show, we have to give them convergent platforms where they can interact, speak into the story, that they can tweet about it, they can text in, they can build a little forum. You know, if you have a convergent website along with the broadcast television model. So we just need to be looking at all the different forms. It's a whole exploding world.
It is.
As we talk.
Well, it is, and you and I go back a few years, which is interesting. You were really on the cutting edge back in the 70s of doing content
right
with a group called I don't know if our audience will remember Isaac Airfreight.
Isaac Airfreight. We started and pioneered Christian comedy in the late 70s and all through the 80s into a little bit of the 90s.
And kind of a Christian Monty Python. Would that be accurate? Or
Yeah. Very Monty Python-ish. Even though we were a little bit before Saturday Night Live, it was basically the style that Saturday Night Live was going to give birth to in 1975 of sketch-oriented humor with a lot of improv within it. And, you know, the church really welcomed us with open arms. I think at that time, you know, we just came out of the hippie movement and the Jesus people, and you saw all these rock and roll bands happening in early Christian music. And suddenly, I think the body was saying, you know, we'd like to laugh, too. Maybe we're taking our faith a little too seriously. Not that we don't take our faith seriously, but the expression, our humanity, as it meets a righteous God and try to live out this thing called life, you know, we do a lot of funny things. And it's great to be explored through the vehicle of comedy.
Well, and the Lord really took you, you know, through Hollywood and a lot of different paths and journeys. You produced what for CBS?
I was supervising producer for 10 years of The Price is Right game show. And in 8 years, I was supervising producer of David Letterman. I was based in Hollywood, so I would produce his shows whenever Dave would travel outside of New York.
And talk about being a Christian kind of in a very secular mainstream environment. Is that a challenge? Is it tough?
Well, it's tough, but it's also an incredible opportunity. It was a wonderful experience because wherever you go, it doesn't matter how high you are up in Hollywood or in network television or wherever it might be, people are people. They still need a savior. They still need somebody who cares. They still need somebody. So I made it a point. I had 100 people on the crew in Price is Right under me. And I made a point to every day have some kind of touch point with them. I don't care if it's just a pat on the shoulder, but, you know, how's your wife? How's your kids? How you doing? And it's so much so, probably the highest compliment I ever got is when I resigned from CBS, Bob Barker said, Dan, I always saw you as the pastor of Price is Right. And then I thought, okay, that was kind of a well done, good and faithful servant, because it just opened the door where people understood I cared about them. They trust me. I wasn't going to get weird with them. And then they would come to me and they would say, could you pray for me? I'm going through a divorce. My wife just got cancer, or whatever it might be. And so I looked on it as not so much a challenge, although there were aspects where your faith is challenged, but also a great opportunity to love people.
Would stand and help me welcome the 43rd President of the United States, George W. Bush.
My good friend Chuck Wallington, thank you for your invitation, and to all who have given their lives for the sake of the gospel, way to go, amigos. One day soon, we will look into the eyes of our blessed Savior, and he will say something like, welcome home, mi casa is su casa. You know, it takes a lot of courage to do what I did, to run the country, fight terrorists, be anywhere close to Dick Cheney. You know what we call this in Washington? The Cheney reaction. My name is John Morgan. I am a George Bush impersonator and look-alike, an imitator of Jesus Christ. And I'm honored to be with you here today. Thank you. In Christ, the past, it doesn't matter. When you've been redeemed, it's a brand new day. And oh, what a joyous thing it is that old things are passed away and all things are become new. One day, God decided to change my heart. And Jesus said, if you love me, you'll obey me. And those words came back to me one day when somebody said, John, you should become a George Bush impersonator. I said, no, I have friends now. Ephesians 5:1 kept coming back to me time after time. Be imitators of God as beloved children and live a life of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. And he's called me and he's called you to be his image bearers in those everyday places of your life. The incredible life-changing power of Jesus Christ. God bless you. And God bless the United States of America.
We're here at NRB 2014, and it is my honor to introduce the former President of the United States. How are you, my friend?
Better than I deserve.
Yes. Okay, we're in a new political environment. How do you think our current President's doing? Do you want to go there?
Oh, you know, Paul, I don't do that. Yeah. You know, I don't talk about my predecessor or my successor.
You look great. In fact, if you're just tuning in, this is not President Bush, but your name is?
John Morgan. John Morgan, yes.
Now, what brings you to NRB each year? Because I run into you every year.
Well, I love Jesus, and I'm passionate about sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ, and I use my likeness is George W. Bush to do several things. Number one, comedy, and then also to use it as an illustration. See, we're called to imitate Christ as beloved children, Ephesians 5:1 and 2. And what I am is kind of a walking analogy. Yeah. And so it's an excellent opportunity to share the gospel. Every encounter is an opportunity to influence someone else, and we influence them for good, for bad, depending on how we carry ourselves, depending on whether we're in that process of obeying the Holy Spirit and the Lord. You know, John 10:10 says, the thief comes to kill, steal, and destroy. But Jesus said, I've come that they might have life and have it to the full. And when the Holy Spirit nudges you to reach out, to share with someone, the enemy is right there, nipping at your heels to stop that, to hit you with fear and to quench what could be a life-changing encounter.